My week was a bit challenging for me, but thank God for the challenges and thank God for the victory. Amen. God has said, no matter what you're going through, we can have the victory. Hallelujah. This week we had the Children's Week, Children's Day, and so we want to celebrate the Victory Kids. Hallelujah. Let's put our hands together for the Victory Kids. Hallelujah. It's Children's Week, and Bible says children are heritage from the Lord. You know, one day the children are going to become leaders. Hallelujah. They are the tomorrow leaders. So we want to celebrate them because we appreciate what God is doing. And I was saying on Children's Day, my wife was the one that shared the reality of kingdom parenting with us. It's not, you need to just know there are the ways by which kingdom parents behave. Hallelujah. And we need to understand that. The Bible says concerning Abraham, it says he knows Abraham is going to, the reason I chose Abraham is because he would train his children. So kingdom parents must spend time to train their children. Ladies and gentlemen, training is an intentional thing. We must be intentional. You know, we must be intentional about what we are doing. And to train children properly, you have to be intentional. Because if you are not, there's another person trying to train them for you. If you are not training your children, either Satan is training them through internet, television, house help, bringing all sorts of things into their house. You know, a lot of children have been trained by people who come to their home through satanic things. So we need to, if you have not watched that message, please just get into it a little bit and listen to it. If you miss any of the services, you can go online and watch them. Now, it's a lot better than the days where you miss the service all over. But now you can go. Even if you are not on time, immediately after the service, you can go online and watch them. And what to say, don't just watch them. Send them to other people. Let it be a blessing. Share it. And the Lord is going to bless us tremendously in Jesus' name. I don't know what you have been going through, but you will go through it in Jesus' name. The Bible says, let us go to the other side. We are going to the other side. Hallelujah. We are going to the other side of this pandemic. We are not going to die in the storm. You know when he said, let them go to the other side? The storm came. And right in the storm was terrible. But Jesus said to them, peace be still. I don't know what storm you have right now. I say, peace be still. Hallelujah. I want to announce to you that we are getting to the other side with Jesus. Hallelujah. And at the other side, there is great breakthrough for us. There is victory for us. The other side may look hazy, but I want to let you know, by the time you get there, you know that God is there before you. He has made the way. Hallelujah. No weapon of the enemy fashioned against us shall prosper. Hallelujah. This week, we are going to continue the series we have been doing this month on the kingdom of God. We're going to continue on the kingdom of God. You know, and I just want us to, let's rise up for a few minutes and worship the Holy Spirit. The subject of the kingdom of God is so vast that we cannot finish it. That's what Jesus preached. That's what all the disciples preached. So we're going to just worship the Lord for a few minutes and get into the word. Holy Spirit, we appreciate you. Holy Spirit, we appreciate you. Our helper, we appreciate you. The anointing, we appreciate you. You are worthy, Holy Ghost. You are worthy, Holy Ghost. You are worthy, Holy Ghost. My helper. You are worthy, Holy Ghost. You are worthy, Holy Ghost. You are worthy, Holy Ghost. My helper, Holy Spirit, we celebrate you. The anointing, we celebrate you. Our helper, we celebrate you. My teacher, we celebrate you. You are worthy, Holy Ghost.
You are worthy, Holy Ghost. You are worthy, Holy Ghost. My help, my help, my help. You are worthy, Holy Ghost. You are worthy, Holy Ghost. You are worthy, Holy Ghost. My help, Holy Ghost, you are too much, oh. You are too much, oh, Holy Ghost. You are too much, oh. You are the excellent Jesus, you are too much, oh. You are too much, oh. Jesus, you are too much, oh. You are the excellent Father, you are too much, oh. You are too much, oh. Father, you are too much, oh. You are the excellent Holy Ghost, you are too much, oh. You are too much, oh. Holy Ghost, you are too much, oh. You are the excellent. There is something that makes me come into your presence, Holy Ghost. There is something that makes me come into your presence, Holy Ghost, my helper, Holy Ghost, my advocate, Holy Ghost, my teacher, Holy Ghost, the anointing, Holy Ghost. There is something that makes me come into your presence, Holy Ghost.
Holy Spirit, we welcome you. Holy Spirit, we celebrate you. Holy Spirit, we welcome you. We appreciate you. You're the teacher. As we get into this word, I have no power of my own. I ask for your wisdom, for your anointing to teach. As for the congregation, there will be great understanding. There will be insight, there will be revelation. I release and submit my mind to you to only speak that which you want us to hear at this time, and let Jesus be glorified. I pray that the word of God will flow freely, that the word of God will come in demonstration of spirit and of power, that the anointing will flow freely to us, and God will encourage us. I pray that at the end of the service today, nobody will be the same again. Holy Spirit, be free to teach, be free to rebuke, be free to exhort, be free to work miracles. Be free to give insight. I pray that there be great understanding today, and Jesus alone will be glorified. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Blessed be your name forever and ever. Take over my mind totally and be the one to speak, because we've prayed in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Praise the Lord. Throughout this month, we've been looking at the title, The Kingdom of God. And it's very interesting to know that the most important discovery in life you can have is to discover the kingdom of God. I want to say that again. The most important discovery in life is to discover the kingdom of God. And I began to share with us that Jesus did not come to start a religion. Jesus came to start a government. It's not a religion, a government. Jesus did not bring about the kingdom. And Jesus' message was a message of a kingdom. And we looked at the fact that you become a member of religion, but you don't become a member of a kingdom. You become a citizen of a kingdom. Hallelujah. You know, become a citizen of a kingdom. In citizenship, when you are a citizen, you are entitled to certain things from your government. Hallelujah. Like your government, you have what they call citizens' rights. You have responsibility also. And when Jesus came, Jesus did not just, almost all his messages were messages of the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. In this world we are living in, the kingdom of this world has failed. Most leaders of the kingdom, they have failed their citizens. But the kingdom of God does not fail. Hallelujah. And I'm just doing a recap of what we have learned. You know, in a kingdom, everything that you need when you're an ambassador is supplied by your kingdom. Hallelujah. You know, and I want us to take note of these as we walk through this morning. And I started by sharing a story with us. I mean, if you remember some 2 weeks ago, and Pastor Ebuku emphasized that last week also, I started by sharing a story with us about how my wife and I traveled. We all Nigerians, we were traveling to a country, and there was a delay in flight. So by the time we get to one of the Middle East countries, by the time we got to the where we had a stopover, we have missed our flight. And I said, well, we missed the flight. At the beginning, everybody was angry and everything. They promised us that they were going to take care of us, so we should not be worried. As Nigerians, we should all bring our passports. So we all brought our passports, and then they said, don't worry, we'll let you go in, we'll get you a hotel, we'll get you food, because the next flight is 9 hours after. 9 hours. And I share the fact that while we had to wait for 9 hours, I mean, they said they will give us place to sleep and then they'll bring us back to the airport. Suddenly they came back and said, the immigration says all people with Nigerian passports, all Nigerians, that none of us can go inside because of the situation, that we don't have a visa and this and that. But people say, you promised to get us visa, to get us inside. It's not our fault. It's your fault. They said, no, this and that. So we have to sit down in the airport for 9 hours overnight. And then I realized that my wife and I have another citizenship. So we switched citizenship and took our passport, the other passport we have, and gave it to them. Immediately we switched the citizenship, the way they treated us changed. They said, please come. Oh, sorry, we didn't know who. We didn't know you are this. You are from, come. They took us away from the rest of the people, took us to a place, took us through immigration. They started treating us with dignity and love. After that, they brought a car that took us from the airport to a 5-star hotel, kept us here. They said, we can eat any food we want. We had buffet at any time. We slept. We had everything. They really, really, because what did we do? We switched our citizenship. You know. And the next morning, when we go back to the airport, they brought us back. The things were waiting for us. We saw our other brethren. They were there. They sat down. There was no place to take a bath. They were looking so rough food and things like that. And so you find that if we didn't switch our citizenship, would have suffered the same way they suffered. While we had the opportunity to switch citizenship. So this morning I want to talk about switching your citizenship. That's what I want to talk about. Switch your citizenship. You know. And I need us to realize, you see, the thing is that the kingdom of God is real. And you're supposed to say, oh, you've been saying that. Yeah, emphasis. Because most of us does not think it is real. It does not think it is real. The kingdom of God is real. I said we live in a planet called Earth. The word Earth, it means the Hera. And then, but on this Earth, there are two words. The word world means cosmos. Cosmos, two words. You know, I mean, two influences on Earth. The kingdom of God and the kingdom of darkness. And I want to let us know this morning that Satan is called the prince of darkness. Jesus is called the Prince of Light. Jesus is the light of the world. The word darkness in Hebrew means ignorance. While the same word for knowledge also means light. I want to reemphasize the fact that the word darkness in Hebrew also means ignorance. So Satan rules, he is the prince of darkness. He rules in ignorance. His kingdom is based on ignorance. And that is why you need to understand that when you don't, Jesus didn't say, God never said, your greatest problem is sin or Satan. Or he says, but my people perish because they lack what? Knowledge. So your greatest problem is knowledge. Immediately you have light, you have knowledge, the rule of Satan is over. Hallelujah.
Power, you see, and that is why Satan's greatest thing is to keep us in ignorance. As long as he can keep you in ignorance, if you don't know what your citizenship rights are, then you are in ignorance. You know, the simplest way for the devil to defeat you is for you not to know your rights. He says, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall what? Shall set you free. You know, this morning, as we go into this, I want us to realize that the kingdom of God is not in the future, it's now. Hallelujah. The kingdom of God is not where? It's not in the future, it's now. I want to throw a few thoughts to our mind. Listen to me. The first one is that kingdom citizens can never be stranded. Hallelujah. Kingdom citizens can never be stranded. The problem is that many of us, we are not conscious kingdom citizens. You know, kingdom citizens can never be stranded. And I'm going to emphasize that because, you see, you have access to another kingdom, to another system on this earth. Number two, we are not limited to the world system alone. We can switch our citizenship. We are not limited. Ladies and gentlemen, like I said, we are not limited. We're going to take a look at that. I want to throw some thoughts into your mind. We are not limited to this world system alone. You see, and the sad thing is that most Christians are just surviving in the kingdom. They are not enjoying the benefits of the kingdom because they don't know what is their right. They are not claiming their rights. Most, they are just survivors. They say, survivor. Ah, oh boy, how are you there? Man, the survival. In the kingdom, you don't survive. You're supposed to thrive. But when you don't have knowledge, you just survive. So ladies and gentlemen, we must become conscious citizens of the kingdom of God. If not, we will remain in ignorance. We can switch our citizenship in this world as many times as possible as the need arises. Listen to me. When you study the Old Testament, like I said, Jesus did not come to set up a religion. He came to set up a government. And the government shall be upon his shoulder. From the time when Jesus came, from Malachi, between Malachi and Matthew, is about 300 years, 300 to 400 years. Malachi was the last of the old prophets, of the minor prophets. And then the New Testament began in Matthew. Between this space of time, the Romans were ruling. In fact, they were controlling, they were oppressing the Israelites. The concept of the kingdom was fully developed. It's so interesting how God works things out. It was when the concept of the kingdom was fully developed on earth that God brought the idea of a kingdom. And what's the concept of the kingdom? The Roman kingdom was the ruling kingdom. They had their headquarters in Rome. And in Rome, they now have colonies. They have places where they rule over. And one of the colonies was Israel. So the Romans, the Caesar, the king is in Rome. But he has a colony, which is also what happened in Africa several days, years before, when we had colonization. Colonization was similar to the kingdom's setup, where the queen of England is in England, but Nigeria, Ghana became British colonies. So the kingdom system is set up in that way. The kingdom, the Romans were the leader, they were the owner of the kingdom. And so they have colonies. One of their colonies is Israel. So in Israel, they were now oppressing them. In Israel, they set up Roman citizens who were sent to rule there. That was when the concept of the ambassador came. They were ambassador of Rome, representing Rome. And so that was a system that was on. It's so interesting that when God brought Jesus to talk about kingdom, the kingdom concept was what was ruling. Hallelujah. Now, I want you to understand this. You know, when you are a representative of Rome in Israel, nobody can touch you. That's what happened. I showed us who our apostle said, I'm a citizen. When you are a representative of Rome, it's the Roman government that provides for what you want. It's the Roman government that takes care of what is going on with you. It's the Roman government, when you are representing Rome, you walk high. You're not a beggar. People respect you. Roman soldiers protect you. Roman soldiers take care of you when you're representative of Rome, when you come, you know. And so, this was a system that was on. But what I wanted to see is that during that time, it's the same thing when you are representing the kingdom of God. When you represent the kingdom of God, the kingdom soldiers, you become, the kingdom takes care of you in the colony. So what happened is that heaven is the headquarters and the kingdom of heaven, and earth is the colony of the kingdom of heaven. Hallelujah. And God, Jesus came as a representative, and when we become kingdom citizens, we become representative of that kingdom of God. And ladies and gentlemen, you become untouchable. Hallelujah. Because the kingdom that you represent can take care of your need. Hallelujah. I'm saying this because we need to understand that. But let's go a little bit deeper into this. During this time, what the Romans did, that they were oppressing the Israelites. They were oppressing them so much that Israelites began to cry for another kingdom, for another government. Now, what happened is that all the prophets began to say, very soon, God will start another kingdom. And this is the concept you need to understand. They were saying the best kingdom Israel ever had was under David and Solomon. They ruled. They were very powerful. You know, it was a very powerful kingdom. They ruled at that time powerfully. So they are saying God is going to set up another kingdom like the kingdom of David, stronger than them. That kingdom is going to come and is going to release them. It's going to stop the oppression of the Romans. It's going to set them free from this rulership of the Roman Empire. So the prophets began to come. Between those 200-300 years, some prophets came and everybody said, that kingdom will soon be set up. That kingdom will soon be set up. They were looking for somebody who would give them temporary relief from the rulership and the oppression of Rome. That's what they were looking for. And so when John the Baptist came, he said, he announced to them, that kingdom is about to start. Everybody said, oh, this man must know something nobody knows. So they were going to him. Tell us about the kingdom. Tell us about the kingdom. Tell us about the kingdom. And so by the time Jesus came, Jesus said, repent. The kingdom of God is here. They were looking for. Many of them were thinking it's in front. Jesus said, no, it has started. And you see, Jesus did not meet their requirement. He didn't set up a religion. They were expecting somebody who would come and set up a physical kingdom that would fight Rome and take the government from Rome. And so that was why it was religious leader that killed him. Because he didn't meet, at the first, we thought he was the Messiah, but he didn't fit up what he was thinking about. The problem was that Jesus came and told them, the kingdom of God has started. The kingdom of heaven has started. Don't think it's in the future. Like many of us today, we are thinking, oh, in the sweet by and by, when we get to heaven, that's when we're going to get the blessing of the kingdom. That's where we're going to get this. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that you can rejoice now, ladies and gentlemen, because the kingdom of God has started. The kingdom of God is not in the future. It is now. It is now. People are saying, that's what we are talking about. That's why the message is the reality. We are talking about the reality of the kingdom of God. Last week, the pastor said, what is your belief system? What you don't believe, you never experience. The Jews were looking forward to the future. And he's saying it is now. Jesus said it has started. The word repent in Greek means metanoia, which means change your thinking. Why does he say that? Don't think the kingdom of God is still in the future. It is what? It is now. In fact, they came to Jesus and said, Jesus, where is the kingdom? Want to see? Say, oh, the kingdom of God is within you. It's right inside of you. So Jesus came preaching the good news of the kingdom. I said, oh, that's what Jesus... I said to us, Jesus did not preach born again. Jesus did not preach Calvary. He didn't preach the blood. He didn't preach all those ones. No. Check the scripture. The Bible says he preached, and from that time began to preach the good news of what? Of the kingdom. The other time, I would just, for somebody who is listening before, in Mark 2, let's just take a look at a few scripture. What's Pastor Bukky saying? John the Baptist preach the kingdom. Matthew 3:2 says, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And in those days, John the Baptist came preaching in the wilderness and saying, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. That was the message that John the Baptist preached. In Matthew 4:17, when Jesus began his ministry, and from that time on, in Matthew 4:17, Jesus began to preach, saying, repent, the kingdom of God has come. That's what Jesus preached. He didn't preach born again. He didn't preach the blood. He didn't preach the Calvary. He didn't preach most of the things we preach now. What he preached was what? Well, the kingdom of God. In verse 23, Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogue, preaching the gospel of the kingdom. The good news is the kingdom. That's what Jesus preached. Many of us, the good news is Jesus. Yeah, but that's not what Jesus said. Jesus said the good news is what? Is the kingdom of God. The good news. And the healing all kinds of sickness. So the good news that Jesus preached is the kingdom. Ladies and gentlemen, when you study the scripture, look at, it says, Pastor Bukku showed us last week, says, I must go to other places so I can preach the kingdom. Jesus, he didn't even preach himself. But he said to Nicodemus, you must be born again. Yeah, Jesus spoke to Nicodemus about being born. He just spoke to an old man one night, just one night alone. He spoke to an old man one night and says, what was he talking to about? The man says, Master, how can I enter? How can I come into the kingdom? And he said to him, oh, if you want to get to the kingdom. Then he showed him the door to the kingdom. I am the door. You have to be born again. You have to be born into it. So what we have done is that we have overemphasized the door. Thank you. Emphasized the door. We have overemphasized the minor at the expense of the major. The reason people are not coming to Christ is because we are preaching the door. We need to preach the kingdom. When you preach the kingdom to people, then they will say, how do I get in? Then you tell them the door. Hallelujah. So this is the door to the kingdom. You know, so we need to overemphasize. They were looking for how to get to the kingdom. I can show you scriptures on the scriptures. Matthew 10:7. If you see again, he says, he told them, when he commissioned the 12 disciples, he told them, as you go, saying, preach, the kingdom of heaven is what? He's at hand. Heal the sick. Preach. Just like heal. That's what he said to them. Look, in the book of Acts, even after Jesus was about to go, after he resurrected, Acts 1, let's see what he says in Acts. After he had resurrected Jesus, still, and verse 3, and to whom he presented himself after himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, appearing to them 40 days and speaking concerning the kingdom of God. So even after he was resurrected, he was about to go. The 40 days he was spent with them, he was still speaking about what? The kingdom of God. Hallelujah. That was what Jesus preached. And then that's what the disciples preached. If you study the book of Acts, it was very clear. Let's take a look at one example. Acts 8. Okay. It was talking about when they went to, when the persecution began in Jerusalem, and they went to Samaria. And the Bible says, this man went to Samaria, and he says, in verse 10, to whom he listened for at least the greatest sin, this man was Gripper. And then, verse 12, but when they believed Philip preaching about the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus, both men and women were baptized. Now, they preach the kingdom and then they tell you about Jesus Christ as the entrance. They now tell about Christ as the way to enter into the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. They talk about Christ. Christ is the door, is the entry to the kingdom of God. But you see, they preach the gospel of the kingdom. Somebody said there about Paul. Didn't Paul preach crucifixion or preach this one? Ladies and gentlemen, Paul preached, but let's look at Paul. I shared it with us the other time, but let's even look at his closing message. Paul wrote the book of Acts, almost half of the New Testament. I want you to notice the story of Paul. Paul was a man that has started several churches. He preached the gospel of the kingdom in all those churches. He was sent to the Gentiles. Paul appealed, was a Roman citizen, and he appealed, he wanted to see God. You know, he appealed to Rome. So God told him he was going to get to Rome. The Roman government paid for all this. You know, so when you are in the kingdom, everything you need will be paid for. They took him to Rome. When he got to Rome, the Bible says, God said, Paul, you have worked hard. You've got hard. You need some holiday. You need to rest. So the Bible says he was taken to Caesar. And then after he spoke his appeal to Caesar, Caesar said, okay, they gave him a temporary release. He was not totally released. And so Paul was put in a house. He was still under arrest. He was put in a house, and everything, his food, his laundry, his everything was paid for by the Roman government. He was having a holiday there. He was resting. That was where he wrote all the book of Acts. All the books he wrote, all these ones that he wrote, all the letters to Corinthians, to Ephesians, to Colossians, that was where he wrote them. God said, Paul, rest. You've had a holiday. The government was paying for him. He was also protected by Roman soldiers. Hallelujah. So the kingdom of God, God is very interesting. He made the Roman government pay for Paul. And then people were coming to see him. They said he was under house arrest. God allowed him to be under house arrest because God wanted him to sit down and write all those letters that he wrote that had become the New Testament to us today. You know, and so if you see what Paul was talking about in the book of Romans chapter 20, sorry, Acts 28. Acts 28, verse 23. So when they had arranged him to be with him, many came to him at his residence. From morning until evening, he explained and solemnly testified of the kingdom of God to them concerning Jesus from the law of Moses and prophet. But he testified the kingdom of God to them. Now let's go to the last verse, which is verse 30. Verse 30. Paul remained 2 whole years in his own rented house. He welcomed all who came to him boldly and freely, preaching the kingdom of God and teaching those things which concern the Lord about the Lord Jesus Christ. So he was preaching the kingdom of God, and then he taught about Jesus. After he has preached the kingdom of God, he would tell them the key of the kingdom is who? It's Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. So what we are saying, ladies and gentlemen, is that you see, that's the message. The good news is the kingdom of God. Why is it the good news? You see, the kingdom of God is the answer to all human problems. Hallelujah. Ladies and gentlemen, in this world we are living in, everybody wants a better government. Last week, Pastor Bukky was saying to us, he said, if they ask you to choose between Nigerian citizenship and another country's citizenship, he said, I already know what he's going to choose. Because people are looking for better government. Even when you go to that place, when you go to the U.S. or you go to places that seems to have better government, people, they are still complaining. They are looking for better government, which is the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. And so when Jesus came, he just said, I have come so that you can have a better government. Hallelujah. He says, I have come so that you can have a better kingdom. And the reason why Jesus came is so that we can enjoy the kingdom of God. Ladies and gentlemen, the kingdom of God is not in the future. The most important, let me say this, the most important need solution to every human endeavor is the kingdom of God. Because the kingdom of God has answers to everything you are going through. You are sick, the kingdom of God has healing. You need provision, the kingdom of God has provision. You need protection, the kingdom of God can protect you. You need help, the kingdom of God has help. So when you preach the kingdom to people, they will say, oh, how can I get in there? Then you tell them you've got to be born again. That's the entrance to the kingdom of God. Now the last few minutes we have left, let's talk about a little bit about, you see, one of the problems with the church is that many of us did not know that we can have dual citizenship. Yes, you are a Nigerian, you are an American, you are this. But you also, when you give your life to Jesus and you become a citizen of the kingdom of God, you are entitled to benefits of the kingdom. Hallelujah. You are entitled to privileges from the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. You know, the kingdom, you see, we can switch our citizenship in this world. I mean, and members of the kingdom of God are never supposed to be stranded. They're not supposed to be stranded. You are not supposed, I mean, because you can have access to help from the other kingdom. When they say there is no healing, you can have access. I remember some years ago, I went to the hospital to pray for a church member. And after praying, I saw a woman came to approach me and said, Pastor, I need your help. I said, yes, you are so troubled. I said, what can I do for you? She said, Pastor, you know, my son here has been ill. And it was those days that they said he has a rare blood. So I've been asked to donate, we need 2 pints of blood. At that time, he says the blood will cost about 6,000 each. But she doesn't have for the whole week. She's been looking for 12,000 to get blood for his son. And then he said, we try to donate, but we can't. He says, and my son is about to die. Can you do anything for me? Can you help us? Even just one. So I said, fine. I looked at her. I said she was genuine. So I followed her to the word. And then when I got to the word, I just wanted to confirm from the matron. Only I got there, the matron said to me, Pastor, don't mind this woman. She's not a serious woman. There's nothing we can do for her anymore. Since Monday, today is Thursday or so. There's nothing we can do for this woman. We told her to go and look for money to buy or get family to come and donate. She will not. Now, how many days? Say the boy is so sick now that he cannot even take blood. Say you can't even give him blood now. Say that if you give any blood to his body now, I don't understand that. Say it will kill him. He says, so it's too late. Just forget it. Say that boy cannot live. By the end of the day, she will be dead. I look at the woman. I said, Lord, what's this? And then so he said, well, Pastor, don't waste your money. I stood for a few minutes. And then it occurred to me that is the human verdict. We can switch citizenship. We can get help from another kingdom. So I said, Madam. So I left the matron. I said, Madam, I said, you see, let me say something. This is what they have said. They don't have solution for you in this kingdom. True story. I said, they don't have solution for you in this kingdom. I said, but I know another person that can take care of the situation. And your son does not have to die. Man said, his eyes blinked. He said, yeah, Pastor, tell me about it. I said, listen to me. I said, there is no incurable disease in the kingdom of God. I said, the kingdom of God has the power to change lives. And I shared the power of the kingdom. And I shared Jesus. The boy was just looking at me like this. And at the point, I said, would you like to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior? He just nodded his head. Couldn't talk. I said, Mama, said yes. I said, good. I said, good news is that there's help from another kingdom. I lay hands on that thing and I curse that disease in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I said, praise the Lord, your son will live. And I gave them the 6,000 at that time. I said, give the bloody one. I said, it's not necessary. I said, take, in case she needs it. And I left. I didn't go there for 3-4 days until maybe Sunday or so. This was happening on a Thursday or so, or Monday. I can't remember. Sunday or Monday, I went. When I went, after I went to see the person, one of our mothers was sick, after I was just going to drive out, I saw a woman running after me. Stop, stop, stop. So I stopped. I looked at her and said, Pastor, you don't recognize me? I said, no. Say, I've been waiting for you. They discharged us since yesterday. I've been waiting for you. I said, I don't understand. He said, my son that you prayed for has been healed. God says, after you left, we prayed for him. I looked as if he was going to die, but suddenly things changed. And they discharged us yesterday. In fact, I was waiting for you that any day you come, these boys should follow you and they begin to live in your church. And I started laughing. I said, don't live in our church. Now listen to me, Madam. Jesus Christ began at our home. Ladies and gentlemen, you see, what happened was that in this system, there was no more hope. Medically, in this system, there was no healing. But we switched system. We, in the kingdom of God, you see, you cannot be stranded as a kingdom citizen. Hallelujah. We are not limited to the system of this world. That was one of the things that Jesus came to show the children of Israel. The disciples was that. Look at the story of that woman with the issue of blood. She has spent all she had in this system. There was no healing for her. She spent all she has on doctors. They've given up on her. Ladies and gentlemen, but one day she met Jesus. But in the other system, ladies and gentlemen, there is healing. In the kingdom of God, there is healing. In the kingdom of God, there is no disease that is incurable. Hallelujah. And I'm saying that the privilege of one of the privileges that we can switch system. That woman with the issue of blood touched the hem of his garment. And the Bible says, he immediately, she was made whole. Jesus Christ came to let the children of, the disciples know that, look, in the worldly, you are not limited. You have an alternative. Ladies and gentlemen, when they said in this system, there's no hope, what do you need to do? Switch your system. Switch citizenship. I say, hey, I belong to another citizenship. Like we did. Like my family did. Say, we belong to another citizen. See, another country, another kingdom. And in that kingdom, there is always hope. If you look at the story, there was a story of another centurion that the son was sick. And the Bible says, he had given up. The son was going to die. He was in another city. He went to look for Jesus. He got to the place and they asked him, Jesus said, what do you want? He said, come with me to my city, because before my son will die. But Jesus said to him, no, I don't have to go with you. See, you have another, you can switch system. Say, in this system, they say your son will die. But in this system, there is healing. And the kingdom of God took over. Hallelujah. I want to let us know this morning, the Bible says that the law of the spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set me free from the law of sin and death. In this other system, in this kingdom, is the law of sin and death that operates. But in the kingdom of God, is the law of the spirit of life. When you begin to operate the law of the spirit of life, you are set free from the law of sin and death. Ladies and gentlemen, there's a law of spirit of life. There's a law of the kingdom. There's a law of sin and death. When you switch system, and operate the new law, you are set free. Hallelujah. Kingdom, you are not limited to this world system. You can switch our citizenship. Hallelujah. And begin to enjoy the privilege that is in the other system for us. Hallelujah. You see, when you look at, and that's what Jesus came to teach. That's what Jesus came to teach. He came to show the disciples how they can switch system. I mean, I will never forget when Jesus, when he was about to, Peter and them, they've toiled all night in this system. They couldn't catch anything. But Jesus came, kingdom provision. Jesus came and said, oh, you've tried everything, yes, but let's switch system. Let's switch your citizenship and come and land in this kingdom. Hallelujah. And also, that was abundance for them. I mean, when you look at the story I find this one very interesting, the story of the multitude. They had been with him for 3 days and they were in the wilderness. He said to them, and then he asked them, they said, they came to me and said, send them away because there's no way to feed them. Jesus looked at them and he was just thinking to them. He said, they have no, in this system, there's no way to feed them. You cannot feed them in this system, this world, in the kingdom of darkness. There's no way to feed them. Food has finished. Lack is here. But on the other system, on this other side, the kingdom of God, there is never lack, there's abundance. And so they said, what are we going to do? Jesus said, give them something to eat. They said, oh, we don't have. Everything we have is finished. Even if we have, how can we get enough that will feed 5,000 people in the wilderness? Maybe 8,000 people. Jesus said, oh, what you need is to switch system. Switch system. Ladies and gentlemen, switch system. Most Christians, you are trying to survive. You have survivor mentality. All you need to do is switch system. And they said, so what do? Jesus said, because in this kingdom that I'm in, there is always abundance. That's what they did. He said, okay, let's operate the system. This system operates by sowing and reaping. So he said, I need seed for you to take the system. For you to, if you are switching system, in my other kingdom, there's abundance. So he said, bring seed for me. So, oh, yes, there's a boy that has, five bread and 3 fishes. So they brought the seed. You see, in this system, there's abundance, but you can't assess the abundance without following the law. The law says you must sow so you can reap. So they brought the loaves of bread as a seed to Jesus, and then Jesus multiplied it. By the time they finished, they had 12 baskets in abundance, because in this system, there's abundance. Hallelujah. And I'm saying that, you see, we can switch system. This system can provide for us at any time, at any moment. I mean, it has a perfect way of, I'm so thrilled. One of the things I've enjoyed about the kingdom of God is that God can get you the blessing from anywhere. You are, in the kingdom, you are never stranded. Well, immediately, some years ago, I was coming from Canada. Some of you have heard my testimony. I was coming from Canada, and a friend of mine gave me some money, hundreds of dollars, to give to his brother or sister. I can't remember very well. Brother or uncle or something at that time. So the person will meet you at the airport. And I help other people to carry their load. I help some people to carry their bags. When I got to the airport, the lady at the counter was very nasty to me and said, this thing was about overweight, about 2 kg or 1 or so. I have to pay a whole. So I realized that the money that man gave me, 3/4 of the money I've spent it to pay for excess luggage. And I didn't want to let, because the people that gave me their bags, they have gone. If I trust in the airport, they will say, pastor stole them, didn't deliver their goods. So many things. So I paid. After I got in the plane, I realized that this man will come to me at the airport to collect his money. And I was saying to myself, now, if I want to start explaining to him that I had to spend money on this, he will begin to tell me, pastor spend their money, this and this and that. So I became dejected. And between Lagos and Paris, I was so oppressed, so dejected, that I didn't have money. How will I get money? Enough dollars, and in Paris, I don't know anybody in Paris. I was just passing through. I'm spending only 2 or 3 hours interval. By the time we landed in Paris, I was so dejected. I was the last one that came out of the plane. As I was coming out of the plane, someone said, something just hit me. I says, why don't you live what you preach? Someone says, yeah. Even in this system, you may not have any help, but the kingdom of God, you can switch, you belong to the kingdom. And that kingdom, see, my people shall not be put to shame. That kingdom, you can switch system, switch kingdoms, switch citizenship. So I switched to my kingdom citizenship. I said, oh, praise the Lord. My God supplies all my need according to his riches and glory. And I began to praise worship. I began to worship God in the airport. And Satan was saying, no, you can't. I said, yes, I can do it. And I began to worship, praise him, exalt him. I began to walk around the airport. After doing that for almost, you see, you'll be tested. I said, Lord, thank you for supplying my need. Thank you because I will not be put to shame. Satan said, how, what can God do? I will never forget that. Satan said, what do you expect God to do between Nigeria, Paris and Nigeria? What do you want God to do? What can God do between this little time? It's not possible. I said, Satan, it's not your problem. I began to worship. Say, Lord, because in that system, it's over. It's disgrace. But in this system, no. So I began to worship. After doing that for about 30, 40 minutes, my spirit was lifted. As I was about to go and sit down, I saw a man on the telephone. He says, he said, Pastor Bukky. I said, Pastor Bukky. I said, yeah, it must not be me because I don't know the man. He said again, yeah, sir. He was telling the other man on the other telephone, saying, it is Pastor Bukky, sir. I'm sure he's in. I said, are you sure? I said, yeah. Then he called my name, said, Pastor Bukky. I said, yeah. I said, oh, sorry, my boss at the other side wants to speak with you. I said, really? Your boss? He said, yeah. How do you know? He said, I know you, sir. You don't know me, but I know you. I said, oh, okay, fine. Bring the phone. So I spoke to the boss. I said, oh, Pastor Bukky, praise God, you are in Paris. I said, I'm not in Paris, sir. I'm passing over. He said, no, just stay there. I'm coming to the airport to see you. I said, So you can't go without praying for me. I thought it was a joke. I started laughing. He said, no, I'm coming there to see you. He said, I've been trying to see you, but now that you're in Paris, there's an opportunity. I'm not very far from the airport. And the plane is going to leave in about 2 hours' time. I was waiting. And the man said, don't worry, I'll make it. Exactly 1 hour to departure when they were about to leave, the missman came in. I said, Pastor Bukky, I've been looking for you. It is this and that. I said, oh, you want me to pray? He said, hey, okay, pray. So I prayed with him. I said, he just took out an envelope. He said, listen, this is money that I've received. The God said, look, I want to give this money, $1,000 to Victory Sanctuary, and then this one to you, dollars, ladies and gentlemen. And then he says, it's a seed that God has given to you. And I started laughing. When I entered the plane, I put the money in my pocket. I said, Satan, did you see what God can do between now and Paris, between Paris and Nigeria? With the space, you see, you can switch system. Hallelujah. The thing amazing is that man in Paris, they don't spend dollars. They don't spend dollars. But dollars is what I need to give at the airport. By the time I got to Nigeria, the person was waiting and collected his dollar cash, and I still had extra for myself. Ladies and gentlemen, you see, we can switch system. The kingdom of God can give us, you see, in this system, they may tell you that it's over with your bank account. But in this system, it says, oh, ladies and gentlemen, this is what they said. I have opportunity to another account. My God shall supply all my need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. My God supplies all my need. We have a system that we can switch. Hallelujah. We have a system that we can switch. We don't have to be dependent on that system. They may tell you in this system, you are broke. But tell them, no, I can switch my citizenship. In another citizens, oh yes, there's abundance for me in that citizen. Hallelujah. Ladies and gentlemen, when you study the word, you see how Jesus worked that. I was reading. When you understand that, many of us, we trust a system that even fails. Because you work for the government, ladies and gentlemen, you are sure that at certain days of the year, every month, they will pay your salary. You don't have to see, but you believe it. The problem with this system is when you in the kingdom of God, when you are in doubt, you miss the blessing. But people doubted the king. They won't doubt government, but you will doubt the kingdom. Hallelujah. At every 28th of the month, every 30th of the month, a check is deposited in your system. And you know, the government does not fail. If human government can do that, how much more your heavenly Father? Because God has a system that works for us. Hallelujah. I was looking at it. Ever before the need arises, the answer is waiting. Hallelujah. God knows. Look at this pandemic that happened. Some government, they were depositing money into the account of their citizens. They woke up and they found money in their account. God said to me, that system is working. How much more the kingdom of God provisional system? He says, but if you don't believe, you will not see it. How do you believe? I was reading the story of Jesus was about to enter Jerusalem. Ladies and gentlemen, he was about to enter Jerusalem. And when he got to Jerusalem, I mean, the prophecy says he was going to, he would ride on a donkey that no one has ever ridden. I mean, I was wondering how would that, but the Holy Spirit knows. So he made preparation. Ever before the need arises, your kingdom already has need, has already made provision. And so the Bible says, Jesus said, go to that house. I mean, you can see that story. It's there. It's in Matthew. It says, Matthew 21. It says, when you get there, he said, go and ask. Tell them that the Lord has a need of it. Matthew 21 verse 2 says, saying to them, verse 2 and 3, go over into the village opposite you. Immediately you find the donkey tied and a colt with her. Two of them. Can you imagine? Two. A donkey and a colt. Somebody thought it was one. No, it's two. It says, untie them and bring them to me. And then he said, if anyone says anything to you, tell them the Lord has a need of it. And he will send them to me immediately. Hallelujah. I want you to take note of that word, the Lord. The Lord. What the Lord means? The Lord is the owner of everything. In the kingdom, the Lord owns everything. Ladies and gentlemen, the Lord of heaven and earth is Jesus Christ. When he has a need of anything, nobody can stop him. Hallelujah. Let me tell you something. Some of us, I mean, when he has a need of a donkey, nothing can stop him. He's the Lord. He said, tell them the Lord. That was a citizenship word. That's a diplomatic word. The Lord has a need of it. And the Bible says, they said, yeah, oh, the Lord has a need of it. Some of you, your donkeys are tied down. The Lord has a need of it. Hallelujah. The reason some of the things you need, I've not got it because it's not yet time. When time comes, when the Lord says it's time for you to have it, nothing can stop you. Hallelujah. Two donkeys. The first one represents some of your properties that are with other people. Ladies and gentlemen, I speak to you. Some of you, your properties are with the world. They are with the Gentiles. They are with the wicked people. Bible says there will be a wealth transfer. When it's time, when it says the Lord has a need of it, the Lord, it will be transferred back to you. Hallelujah. The other one is, look, there are some of you that have not been used at all. The other donkey has not been ridden. It's not been ridden at all. Those things, they will come to you. Because when the Lord says he has a need of it, nobody can stop it. That thing you need most, when God says he has a need of it, no human being can stop it. The Lord is the Lord. He's the Lord of the harvest. He's the Lord. Hallelujah. Let me close by saying, in this system, there is protection. Hallelujah. I mean, we can switch. We can switch. I mean, I said, in the system, in the kingdom of God, in any kingdom, citizens don't fight battles. It is the soldiers that fight. The same thing happens in the kingdom of God. It is angels that fight battles for us. I mean, and I want to say, listen, in the system of God, in the kingdom system, you can never, never be held. There's always deliverance. Hallelujah. Remember the story of the three Hebrew boys. They said to them, they said, look, they said, if you don't bow, you will die. They said, who is this God that will deliver you? Those boys looked at him. Yes, deliver you from my hand. King Nebuchadnezzar was the strongest, the most powerful man on earth. He controls everything. So who is that person that will deliver you? Those boys looked at him and said, yes, in this system, we will not have deliverance, but today we switch system. And they switch into the kingdom. See, this verse says, King Nebuchadnezzar, we don't mind to say anything to you. Listen, the God that we serve is able to deliver us, and he will deliver us. And there was a warfare. They wanted to show. Satan wanted to show. They said they were going to get them killed. But there was a battle between hell and earth. I mean, there was a battle between heaven and hell. And immediately, I mean, the hell says, no, Nebuchadnezzar got angry. He said, I was going to throw them into fire. The Bible says they threw them. I mean, they were going to throw them. As they were about to throw them, three Hebrew boys, those angels, I mean, it says, multiply the fire, make it 10 times more, stronger than it was before. But those boys says, listen, the God that we serve, in this system, God will deliver us. And as I read the story, I began to imagine, I saw, the Bible says there were three kinds of angels in heaven. I always love that story. There is the guardian angel. Those guardian angels has two wings. Those two wings were there. God says, who will go and deliver them? Because he wants to take care of our boys. Says, who will go and take care of our boys? The guardian angel says, I will get there. Says, oh, the guardian angel showed up. Says, how long will it take? He says, 3 minutes, I'll be in the fire. God says, oh, no, it's too late. It's too late. Those boys would have burnt by that time. And they are called the guardian angel. The second kind of angels are the cherubs. The cherub has four wings. They use two to fly and two to praise God. And so the cherub came and said, we will go for you, God. God said, how long will it take you to get there? He said, in 2 minutes, we'll be there. Oh, God said, oh, cherub, Calvary cherub, it's too late. They will have been burned. And then there's a third kind of angel in Isaiah chapter 6. Also, they are the seraphims. The seraphims have six types of wings. They have six wings. Also, they use two to fly, two to praise God, holy, 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 and two to cover their face because they stay in the presence of God all the time. They are the most powerful angel in heaven. God says, the seraphim says, I will go. He says, how long will it take you to get there? He says, oh, in 1 minute we are there. God says, no, it is too late. They would have been burned. And then suddenly, Jesus, the Son of Man, the Son of God, came and said, Father, I will go and save them. And he says, oh, Father said, so how long? He says, oh, I'm already in the fire. Hallelujah. And the Bible says, by the time they threw those boys into the lake of fire, the fourth man was in there with them. I pray this morning, the fourth man will be there with you. Hallelujah. The fourth man will be there. But said, when they got to the fire, they didn't burn. The fire became an air condition because a system, a kingdom is stronger than the other one. Whenever Satan wants to put you down, your kingdom is stronger. Hallelujah. And the kingdom shows up. Oh, yes. So, King God said, oh, my goodness. What did I see? There's somebody there that looks like the Son of Man. He said, there's someone there that looks like the Son of Man. He said, oh, my goodness. So, let's come out. Two kingdoms clash, but the stronger kingdom won. Hallelujah. Your kingdom is stronger. Ladies and gentlemen, our kingdom that we serve is stronger. Jesus said, this is my kingdom. It's not the kingdom of this world. He said, Pilate, I don't need to deal with you. If you are not careful, read this. It's there, Matthew 26, 52. Matthew 26, 52 says, I could command legions of angels. Oh, my goodness, ladies and gentlemen, we got to switch system. Because, you see, people of the kingdom can never be stranded. Oh, there's always deliverance. Kingdom protection, kingdom deliverance. Let me close with this. Sometimes ago, I was going to travel. We're going to Loring or something for something, and I woke up that morning in my prayer, and God said, don't travel late, travel early. So I planned to travel early. I got everything ready. And I remember specifically that day that somebody wanted to follow me. A sister wanted to follow me. And I said she can't finish on time, she'll be late. So I had to just wait, and she came a bit late. So we left. By the time we got to the express road, it was blocked. And then we got to Ibadan a bit late in the night. And then we were still going to pass through Ibadan. And I was sleeping. I was about to get out of Ibadan. I remembered I was sleeping. I remember that suddenly, something woke me up. Says, we were double-crossed in front. We thought they were policemen. They were armed men. Several of them would cover their face. Blah, blah, blah. I thought they were policemen. And that thing just woke me up. Said, wake up, wake up. I said, yes. He says, get out now. Take your bag and get out now. I thought, was saying I should get out and go and accost those. I said, get out now. So I got up, opened the door, and I went out. As I went out, one of them was coming towards me, but he didn't see me. And I went and I stood there. And then he got into the car. I said, where is the man sitting here? Where is the man sitting here? And then he said, gru, 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 gru. They started shooting, brah, brah. And they drove the car away. And God was so good. I mean, all the money I had, which was not even, I had some dollars I was supposed to give somebody, was there in my pocket. Everything was there intact. I kept it. So he said, get out now. After we did that, I was troubled. So I went to the police station. Cut long story short, went to the police station. They reported that they took my car. And so the policeman said, oh, they took your car. I said, ah! He said, describe. They called the VPO. The person said, oh, yes, oh. Said, oh, it's a notorious gang. Say, nobody can cut him. Say, unfortunately, you see, he said, do you have any insurance? I said, yes. He said, what's the name? I said, Jesus Insurance. The man laughed. He said, do you have any, what do you call it? Any tracker? I said, yeah. I said, Jesus tracker. He laughed. You know, then he asked for me one other thing. Do you have one other thing? I forgot it. I said, yes. Before I said, he said, Jesus. So I said, yes. He said, anyway, Pastor, I just want to tell you, I'm sorry. There's nothing we can do much about this. These people, they are very notorious. When they take the car, they take it across the border. And nobody can stop them. I said to him, I said, listen, I said, excuse me, sir. I didn't come to report you so you can take my car for me. I said, I want to let you know that angels will go after those people and get my car for me. But unless they get the car and bring them back, I'm going back to Lagos so that you will know where to track me. The man looked at me and said, yeah. I said, yeah. Because we have a system that protects us. We have soldiers. So he said, are you sure? I said, yes. I said, so I reported. Ladies and gentlemen, the next day, they called me at one p.m. in the afternoon and told me that car has been found. So when I take back and I went back, they said that night, those people, they took the car. Truly, they took it to Oyo, they passed Oyo, they went through the border. They were about to cross the border. They had changed. They had wore clothes like Islamic clothes. They looked like Lawani. I mean, all sorts of things they put on, nicely dressed. They wanted to cross across the border. But I was told that, I mean, a military guy who is a captain at that time, he's still my friend. We still spoke about a few weeks ago. He said he was about to sleep. Somebody told him, you cannot sleep. Go and do some investigation at the border. He said he couldn't sleep. He says, no, go. Take your team. Go across the border. They got to the border. I said, go across. They went across. So this team, this set of thieves took our car. They took two of those cars. They were following each other. One is a pickup. The other one is a jeep. And they were following each other. And they got to the past customs. They passed immigration. And they passed policemen. So they crossed the border. And then there was a space. And these soldiers were there. None of them stopped them. Every other stopped them. They say, oh, we are from the emir. We are on official duty. So they let them go. When they got to that place outside the border, this Nigerian army men stopped them. And they asked them, where is, can you stop? They said, no. They said, we are from the emir. The man said, I don't want to listen to anything. Can you stop and come down for searching? The man said, we are emir on special duty. No, we don't want to hear. Come, down for searching. So they came down for searching. Ladies and gentlemen, when they came down for searching, the man said, the first thing he noticed in the car was a Bible, my big black Bible. The man said, he said to them, you are from the emir. And this guy is filled with Bible, not just one. Is emir reading the Bible now? Immediately he said that. Say, arrest them. Two of them tried to run away. They shot them. And ladies and gentlemen, they brought the car, took the car, nothing missing, nothing broken, everything. They brought it back to that same police station in Ibadan. And ladies and gentlemen, when I went to get it, the DPO called me and said, Pastor, you said it. Where is your church? He says, I want to start attending your church in Ibadan. I want to start attending. I said, no. I said, it is not me. It's the angels. Hallelujah. Ladies and gentlemen, it's the angels that went after. They are the soldiers that protect the citizens of the kingdom. Nothing missing. When they came into the car, they were looking for me, but I was standing there. They didn't see me. Hallelujah. And I'm saying everything was gotten back because the enemy set an attack, but our angels were there. They went after. Nigeria police says they can't do it, but angels of heaven was after them. Ladies and gentlemen, as I close this morning, remember you can change your system. You don't have to. You don't have to be in that place. You can switch systems. Switch systems. Let's rise up on our feet as we pray. Switch systems. Switch citizenship. Switch your citizenship. You have the privilege. You are a Nigerian, good, but you're also a citizen of the kingdom of God. This is the last time you ever be stranded in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. When things don't work, no, you have access to a higher citizenship.